Hello there, Kyle Katarn here, and it is Wednesday, my dudes. You know what that means. Time to read some comic books. I am all about it. Actually, today it's a nice, quiet, rainy Wednesday morning where I live. And I don't know about you, but I always enjoy reading a little bit more when it's rainy outside. Just provides a nice cozy atmosphere, I guess. So we've got two new comic releases today, both of which are canon. We've got Star Wars number 7 by Charles Soule and Ramon Rosanas. And we've got Star Wars Adventures number 1. Yes, Star Wars Adventures has returned with a new line focusing on Resistance-era storytelling and a new thing called Tales of Villainy, which I'm interested to check out. Star Wars Adventures was by Michael Moreci and Ilias Kimazis. I'm sorry, I butchered that name. I'm going to have to correct myself on that later. But yeah, we're going to start off with Star Wars number 7. And since it's written by Charles Soule, and I know how much this man loves to flex his continuity muscles, I'm going to have my eyes peeled for any references to the upcoming High Republic book, Light of the Jedi, which he wrote. Because he loves planting seeds, you know what I mean? Alright. Onwards. Star Wars number 7. Action-packed cover. We've got Zara over here on the right, Leia on the left. I like Zara as a character design. She gives me strong Admiral Dalla vibes. Dalla from Legends showed up first in Jedi Search, I think, from the Jedi Academy trilogy. We've got an ISD blasting down on an MC-85 with some interceptors, and I see an X-Wing. We got a Nebulon B frigate down at the bottom. Zara's got an E-11. And Leia's holding a DH-17, and of course we got Wilhuff Tarkin looming in the background here. I'm not sure what planet that is, but I bet it's not Alderaan. Alright. Oh, we got people. Trevor Timmis, hello there. Henry Lewis. J-C-K-T-O-A-O, I don't know how to pronounce that, but how you doing, man? Beautiful Harry. I-XM, how you guys doing? Yes, I do stream every Wednesday for the comics. It's just an easier way to read them and react to them without having to do it all after the fact like I used to do. So here we go. Star Wars number 7. Star Wars issue 7 by Charles Soule and Ramon Rosanas. Oh, that's right, comic. The Will of Tarkin, part 1. The heroic Rebel Alliance is scattered and on the run from the evil Galactic Empire after losing the Battle of Hoth. Princess Leia attempts to rally her friends before all hope is lost. The freedom of the galaxy is at stake. But their cunning new foe, Commander Zara, will stop at nothing to crush the rebellion once and for all. Another way that Zara really reminds me of Natasha Dalla is that she has this reverence for Tarkin in a very similar way. I don't know if they actually had like a relationship the way that Dalla did, but she definitely seems to be pining for his presence as her mentor now that he's been lost with the Death Star, you know. The Inner Rim, Rebel Fleet, 4th Division. We're getting a transmission from 7th Division, Commander Grek. Standard rendezvous confirmation codes. Oh, nice, you got the Falcon pinned under there. I always wondered about that. When the Falcon docks the Nebulon B, it's like, what else is supposed to go there? Like, is there a complementary craft that is designed to fit in a Nebulon B in that space? Thank you, Lieutenant. Stand by for orders. This is what we've been waiting for, Leia. Do we proceed? I must point out that if we respond to 7th Division's transmission, we will alert the Imperial Battalions hunting us to our location. We all know what's at stake, 3PO. This isn't just about saving our own skins. Proceed, Commodore. Respond with the appropriate codes, and then it's time to strike back. Sounds about right. Sounds like the theme of this storyline. Imperial Star Destroyer, Tarkin's Will. Yeah, I started these reviews after the issue where we were introduced to the Tarkin's Will, so I didn't get a chance to talk about how much I love this design and just the lore behind it, how this ship was present at the destruction of the Death Star at Yavin, and a huge piece of debris flew off and created these huge scratches in the hull. And rather than, decommission the ship or even have it repaired, Zara chose this ship to carry out her revenge in Tarkin's name, and it's Tarkin's Will. That's great. Rebel transmissions confirmed, Commander Zara. 7th Division initiated, and 4th Division replied. 4th Division? That's Leia Organa's group. Set a course immediately. Send the 7th's coordinates to our 2nd Strike Force. Orders are total eradication. Of Of course, Commander. But if I may, the relative positions of the rebel divisions put us... Of course, Commander. But if I may, the relative positions of the rebel divisions put us put the 7th much closer to us, and the 4th near our colleagues. Wouldn't it be more efficient to go after the 7th? If we don't move quickly, there's a chance the rebel ships might move on. Zara's a glory hound. She wants to kill herself, and I think that might end up being her undoing here. That clenched leather fist. Very well, Lieutenant Gore. Set a course to the rebel fleet, 7th Division. All crew to battle stations. Guess I was wrong. The commander didn't seem too happy about not being able to go after the 4th. I don't get it. They're all just rebels. What's the difference? Didn't you hear? The 4th Division has Leia Organa aboard their command ship. For Commander Zara, the princess is the prize. Really? Do you think it has something to do with the Death Star tragedy? After all, we were all lost someone when it was attacked. People said Organa was linked to the plans being stolen. She had some connection to that traitor, Galen Erso. Nice. I'm not sure. I've only heard rumors. But I think it's bigger than that. For Commander Zara, when it comes to Leia Organa, it's personal. It certainly seems to be that way. Years earlier, the Outer Rim, Eriadu. Oh, nice. Okay. That's the Carrion Spire, and Eriadu is where Tarkin is from. In the Tarkin novel by James Luceno, so this is a great reference. I see you, Char's soul. I require a protege. I do not require 3. You have all benefited from my instruction and influence as you rose through the Imperial Academy. I originally selected you because you had no other ties, no families, no distracting entanglements. You all scored at the highest levels in the Empire's selection exams. Your potential was notable, and your performance to date bears that out. Now you will show me something that no examination can test for. Worth. They've gone just full-on Nazi with this depiction right here, with the black leather trench coat draped over his shoulders. He looks like he's looking for the goddamn Ark of the Covenant right now. Like, straight up. Very on the nose. Although, I will say, I do like the look of the Imperial officers garbed in these cloaks with the hoods around. Like, that's a good look. How you doing, Gonk Sixes? And Trevor, I agree with you. Tarkin is absolutely the man. The man with the plan. This area is the Carrion Plateau. I named it my flagship after this place, the Carrion Spike. My family has owned this land for generations. It is where we demonstrate our fitness to carry out the Tarkin legacy. Somewhere in the forest, a Veermach hunts. It has none of the natural advantages of its kind. It is an albino, so it stands out against the foliage. It should have died shortly after birth. Instead, after a lifetime of constant struggle, combat, and survival, it is now the deadliest predator on the plateau. Belden, Hanovic, and Zara, you will be the first people not named Tarkin to hunt here in many generations. I will remain here for 12 hours until dawn. If you wish to leave with me when I go, find the beast of which I spoke, and bring me its head. All right. The sun goes down. Night falls over the Carrion Plateau. I always respect it when we can get these multi-panel transitions conveying everything that we need to know about the situation non-verbally. Just let the art tell the story. I took the beast in the trees where I believed it was safe. Where it believed it was safe. It wasn't. Look at that thing. Tongue hanging out. I love it. Oh. And the others, your colleagues. The day the terrorists killed my parents, I understood that life had no interest in playing fair. Since that day, I've seen with my eyes, not my hopes. For instance, here I saw immediately that you sent us to hunt 3 quarries, not just the Veermach, but others. The others took longer, but in the end I helped them understand. When it came down to it, they were unworthy. She's pretty cold, and I bet you Tarkin's all about it. If you would just get out of my way and let me do my job, Governor Tarkin, you would see that your concerns about Project Stardust, nice, are utterly unfounded. I love that we're getting Krennic here. Director Krennic, my concerns exist precisely because of the manner in which you are executing your responsibilities. Or more accurately, the manner in which you are failing to do so. It was pointless to rebel. It is pointless to resist. Whew, for a second there, I thought that was Rebel Callus, and I almost had a heart attack. But I'm sure it's not. They wouldn't do that to us, would they? Hey, Gonk69. I've got a lot of gonks in the chat. I love it. Harvey, Handsome Jack, the best... Yes, Krennic, best Space Australian Glory Hound of all time. Yeah, Ben Mendelsohn, perfect choice for that role, and he really milked it. It takes a certain brash personality to take an officer's admiral's uniform, like his white ISB, and add a fucking cape. Amazing. I know he wasn't ISB. I know that he was in the engineer corps of the Imperial whatever, but I will always call it an ISB uniform because... I mean, a Grand Admiral uniform, because that's how it always was in Legends. Shall we ask Captain Zara about her assessment of the Rebel position, Lord Vader? I think you might be interested in her grasp of tactics. She's been paying close attention to my methods for quite some time now.
Yes, I have heard of this one, your little foundling.
That's a great... I like it. Now we're hearing this word a little bit more. You've distinguished yourself during our years together, Lieutenant Commander Zara. I have a mission for you. This is a warlord named Burnium Rowe. He is operating out of a stronghold in the midrim world of Ikruk. You will take a strike force and destroy his operation. I have duties on the Death Star, so I will not require the carrion spike. You may utilize it for the rest of the mission. I trust this will be sufficient. More than sufficient, sir. In fact, it may be overkill, if you'll forgive me for saying so. But why so much firepower? Couldn't we send in an assassination squad? This man, Roe, is utilizing rhetoric and imagery associated with an obsolete criminal organization known as the Nile. The Nile. The big bads from the High Republic, if I'm correct. At one point, this group wreaked great havoc across a wide swath of the galaxy. They were agents of chaos. I understand. Chaos goes against everything this empire stands for. We bring order and the peace naturally derived therefrom. A message must be sent. I won't let you down, Governor. Go, Zara. Bring me his head. Peak Tarkin right here. Okay, so this is explaining away why she wasn't present on the Death Star when it exploded, I guess. Because she wasn't on the Tarkin's will. She chose that ship after the fact, so this must be where she was. Thank you, Moostick. Yeah, I really wasn't sure what to do with Tarkin, so I'm just channeling, "You may fire when ready," in like every phrase that I say. Mid-rim, Ikruk. The probe droid network is up and running, Commander Zara. I've never heard of probe droids being used this way. What made you think to do it? They're sensitive devices, capable of much more than just detecting life signs. Arrayed properly, they can create an extremely effective surveillance net. And they're mobile. I love these Star Wars lo-fi girls up here. Imperial lo-fi girls. That's what I'm going to call them from now on. Thanks, prequel memes. They can move to follow a quarry, provide targeting data, verify kills, much like perfectly trained hunting droids. And they never turn traitor. I'll take a droid over a flesh and blood spy any day. As far as how I devised the tactic, I've always considered my resources as broadly as possible. For instance, this water. You can drink it, or boil it, and it's a sterilizing agent. Frozen, it preserves food or acts as a hammer or weapon. You can drown someone in it. Water can loosen tongues. Many effective interrogation techniques utilize water. Everything is a resource. My mentor taught me that. Commander, we have something. The droids picked up Burnium Row, leaving a social club in Grail City. Resolution's a little low, but visual identification confidence is at 93%. We can take him now. Got the Vipers just hiding behind. Yeah, exactly. They're listening to the lo-fi jams while subjugating entire worlds. You know, it'd be like that sometimes. We can take him now. No, not yet. We're not just here for Ro. We are here to send a message. Let's follow this rat back to his nest. Alright, and this is where he went. There's the terrorist base. Perfect. Let's show this Ro how much trouble he's in. Turn off the cloaking system. Yes, Commander.
You guys see that? Yeah, what is that?
Actually, no. That would be more of a... As it, like, the shield dissipates, you know?
Uh-oh.
Just destroying him. Are the probe droids detecting any life signs?
Negative.
Well, it sounds like mission accomplished. Set a course for the Death Star. Okay, so she did return to the Death Star. Burnham Row. Every time I see Burnham Row, I keep my brain wants to say Bo Burnham, which really changes the story. Burnham Row has been neutralized, sir. And let me thank you for allowing me to use the carrion spike. That is one extraordinary... Where is his head, Zara?
His head?
Yes, Commander, I was explicit. I told you to bring me his head. But I thought that was a figure of speech. I assure you, the mission was a complete success. We destroyed Burnham Row and his entire operation. Burned it to ash. There was nothing left. Do you believe so? Then who is this?
The Imperials sent their death squad to take me out, but look at this. I'm still here. They can't kill me. I'm Burnham Row, and now they're gonna pay. Nothing's gonna stop us now.
You did not kill Burnham Row. You killed one of his decoys, made to look like him, distractions for assassination attempts. And now this insignificant criminal is using your mistake to elevate himself. This broadcast went out across the shadow feed. This is an embarrassment, Zara. Your mission was a failure, and do you know why? A Tarkin looks their enemy in the eye and puts their blade in their throat. You did neither, and so you failed. I thought I knew who you were, Commander. I was mistaken. All I know is what you are not. Man, Tarkin always comes in with the sick burns. Jacqueline, I lived, bitch! Pretty much. That's pretty much the meat and potatoes of what he's saying here. And Tarkin's not having it. This informs why Zara is so hell-bent on going after Organa personally. Seeing her, looking her in the eyes, putting that blade in her throat. She wants to do it the Tarkin way. Yeah, the shadow feed does sound cool. It's like, it's either something really badass, or it just turns out to be like Galactic 4chan. Could go either way.
What do you mean I can't go in? I have new intelligence on the location of a high-value target. I guarantee the governor will want to see it.
Governor Tarkin has given explicit instructions, Commander. You are to report to the personnel office for reassignment.
This is ridiculous! I outrank you by multiple levels. I order you to inform Tarkin that I have located Burnham Row.
Again, Commander, this is not my decision. I have instructions from the governor, which you do not have the authority to countermand. You are to report to the personnel office for reassignment.
Fine. Just tell him... Tell him I understand.
Move aside, Trooper. I require this shuttle.
Now? I'll need to see your authorization.
I am a Lieutenant Commander in the Imperial Navy. That's my authorization, bitch.
But don't you realize we're under attack? The rebels have mounted an offensive.
Unless they've brought another Death Star, what could they possibly do against this station? We're fine.
Regardless, I've been ordered to hold the shuttle for potential evacuation of high-ranking officers. I can't just... Whoosh.
Psh! Nice. Okay, so she actually really had to fight to get out of here, because she almost went down with the ship. Governor Tarkin, I've set this mission to be transmitted to you once I've already embarked upon my mission. Forgive my familiarity, but our relationship is meaningful to me. I've learned so much from you. I would not be who I am without you. You know I would never intentionally fail you. I hope you will give me the opportunity to prove your faith in me was not misplaced. I have taken the shuttle without authorization, but I will soon return it. I will come back to you soon, and I will hand you the head of...
Well, it looks like Burnham Row's off the hook.
No! No.
Awesome. I love that she's got... Well, it's probably hidden behind me, but she's got a little nosebleed going on there. Smashed her head on the cockpit. That's awesome. The explosion of that Death Star, it seems to be like the singular event to cause the most ripples narrative-wise through the Star Wars storytelling, because we've seen it from so many different perspectives at this point. It's really fascinating, actually. So that was her remembering. The Rebel 7th Division will be overwhelmed before long, Commander Zara. Yeah, they're all just going down.
Let's see, all they've got is a Nebulon, a CR-90, and a GR-80, and an MC-85. So, they can't stand up long against multiple ISDs. They just don't have the numbers to stand up to us. I can see that with my own eyes, Lieutenant Gore. Tell me something I do not know. What is happening with the 4th? Yes. We have a report from our secondary strike force. They arrived at the coordinates from which the 4th transmitted, but it seems the rebels were already gone. Blast it, Gore! I told you! Additional rebel ships dropping in from hyperspace. Transponder signals coming up. It's the 4th! Should've known. Of course they're gonna come after you. Also, I find it very interesting that this has been almost entirely from the Imperial perspective for an issue of Star Wars and not Darth Vader. But it's heavily implied what's going on the rebel side. Clearly, an attack was launched on the 7th. Leia convinced the 4th to join them to help defend. That tracks. That's exactly what she'd do. They've caught us in a pincer maneuver. They must have planned this from the start. Ah, so Organa came looking for me. Isn't that something? Order my shuttle prepped, Gore. Are you leaving? Yes, Lieutenant. I need to lead the boarding party. Gotta do it face to face. Well, Zara is a highly motivated, very cool, badass character. Something tells me she's about to die in the next issue. Reading some comments here. Yes, Trevor Timmis, there's no one on Earth that doesn't like that Lambda design. Absolutely right, man. It's a sleek, classy design. I love the way the wings move. Yeah, Inferno Squad's perspective on the Death Star, that's what I first came to mind when she was in the TIE, looking at the explosion. I thought of Iden Versio looking up from Endor for the second Death Star. Oh, and I've lost my chat window. Excuse me. And then we will move on. That was really cool, there were quite a few references in there. Charles Soule loves his continuity. We got a couple references to James Luceno's Tarkin novel. We actually saw Krennic, where they talk about Project Stardust. We went to Eriadu. We saw the Carrion Spike. And then also, they gave us a couple things, like we talk about the Nile from the High Republic. That's going to be very interesting to see how that fleshes out as well. Yeah, no, this issue was really good. Can't wait to see how it all wraps up next time. Princess Leia and the Rebel Alliance strike back! Has Leia ensnared Zara in a trap, or is the battle like another deadly ploy by the cunning commander? This is cool. Cover art by Carlo Pagulian. Pagulian, I think. Love the Death Star exploding in her eye, with the ships coming out on one side, and then just Emperor and Vader and the troopers on this side. Very classy. Awesome. Okay. And next up, we have Star Wars Adventures number 1 by Michael Moreci and Ilias Kenazis. It is the restart. The issue paused. We paused after Vader's castle, I believe. And this is where we're kicking it back off. We got Rey, Finn, and Poe doing something in the jungle. I'm not sure if this is post episode 9 or if this is between 7 and 8, 8 or 9. Hopefully that'll become clear soon here. What's going on? Okay, so it is pre-Rise of Skywalker. I wonder why that's such a dead zone. Why we're not getting anything new in that. Maybe they're saving it and they're going to give us something like big eventually. It does make one nervous. The Obstacle Course, Part 1, that's going to be our Resistance story, followed by Invasion of Echo Base. This is the first in our series, Tales of Villainy, which has been very hyped. So, let's see if they bring it. Alright, IDW, what do you got for me? Noaxon, a moon on the outer rim. No wonder this place is deserted. It's really dangerous. So dangerous. Darkness falls at irregular intervals. Sometimes the surface shifts and upsets the terrain, which only means one thing. It's a bit of a departure. This art style is very different from what I was just reading. It's not bad. It's just a lot more stylized, and I like the very vivid color work. We got this bright red background, neon blue foreground, with just like this purple in the back, in the middle here. I like it. That's how I like my colors. It's perfect. I don't mean to burst your guy's bubble, but... you know, blindfolds don't really work on me, right? The whole thing with the Force and all? So are you two finally going to tell me what this is all about?
No. You tell her, Poe. No, you. I insist. I couldn't. It was your idea, so...
It was a terrible BB-8. Yes, BB-8, believe me. I am keeping that in mind as well. I am keeping in mind that they mean well.
Okay, here goes. Rey, we built you, and you can take off your blindfold now. Right, blindfold. Now, Rey, brace yourself, because we built you a Jedi training obstacle course.
Ooh.
What's gonna go wrong?
All by yourselves? You did this, without help from anyone else, anyone at all.
Well, we had R2 help us design it. He did watch Luke Skywalker train, so... So that's why he's recharging in the Falcon. The important thing is we get your training, because the faster Finn and me get you all trained up, the faster you can join us on missions. Okay, there it is. So now, okay, it makes sense now, because Poe was very irritated at how much time Rey was spending training at the beginning of 9 when he came back from that mission. Right. And we really wanted to help.
That, too, definitely. We're here for you, Rey.
Fine. If you're going to be so sweet about it... Come on, BB-8. I mean, how bad can it be? Probably pretty bad.
This is bad, BB-8. This is really bad.
He's no fool. He just swings across.
Yes, well, not everyone has built-in cables like you do. The lichens on this rock are very slippery, and I get the sense they're fresh. Poe and Finn couldn't have known about them. As long as I can...
Oh, no. And she falls.
Okay,
we're back on solid ground, and we're both in one piece. And we've already made some friends, I guess. We've already made some friends, so I guess this wasn't so... bad! Oh, it was a trap. That's not even just loose ground cover, that's like a straight up... Someone did that on purpose, I think.
Oof!
Please don't tell me dropping into a cavern was part of the...
Well. What do we have here?
Awesome. This is just a smorgasbord. We've got a Quarren, we've got an Athorian. We've got... Homeboy looks like Embo in the back here. Two Weequays, a human, a Chiss. Two humans. And an Abednado. That's awesome. Because we care. Definitely not because I desperately need you to do crazy Jedi shit for us or anything. Pretty much. That's kind of Poe in a nutshell, isn't it? He wears his heart on his sleeve. And he does care, but he tries to act like he's doing it because he cares and not because he really needs a favor.
Definitely not part of the training.
What's taking her so long? She should be on her way back by now. Relax, okay? Just take it easy. Rey can take care of herself. We both know that.
I don't know, Poe. I just have this feeling that...
Oh, shit. My bad.
I don't know, Poe. I just have this feeling that... Something's telling me she's in trouble.
Something tells you this, huh? And let me guess. You're not going to be happy until we go look for her, are you?
Nope.
You know. One of these days, that mushy heart of yours is going to get us into a lot of trouble.
You were saying something about being in trouble?
Says the guy who's outnumbered 2-1.
Oh, I wouldn't be so sure.
Us pirates know a thing or two about ambushes.
Well, looks like our patrol's turning out to be worthwhile after all. Move, both of you.
Nice. I like the art style. The silhouetted with like the brilliant color background like I was talking about before.
You're coming with us. Something tells me that Algron is going to want to have a word with you two.
I think there's a little misunderstanding here. See, my ship, I was having some technical difficulties and...
And what were you doing all the way out here, on a desolate moon in the Outer Rim?
I was, well, I'm here for a survey. An archaeological survey... thing.
Nice thinking on your feet. The hell does Rey know about the world? She's lived on Jakku her whole life. She can't think of a good excuse.
And you expect us to not recognize that staff of yours? That droid? You're the Resistance girl, the one the First Order's looking for. They'll sure pay well for your capture.
I'm sure they will. She's getting ready to kick some ass. But you'll have to catch me first.
Get her! And take her alive!
Now, this Quarren has the least number of tentacles I've ever seen on a Quarren, I think. BB-8, behind you!
Ugh!
Bramp, 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 bramp!
As she's just, like, butterfly kicking people like it's cool.
Kanato, Baka, Gordon, get to the ship! Alert the others and contact the First Order!
We'll get our credits yet.
Go on, move!
Yep, too late.
You'll never catch them. The First Order will be here in no time. You belong to them, and the reward will belong to me.
There's one thing you don't realize, pirate. It's not just me you'd be hurting. It's my friends. And no one hurts my friends. Well, that's cheesy. Come on, BB-8, hurry. We have to get back to the surface before Kylo Ren finds out that we're here. You're right, BB-8. I bet the pirates did take those creatures. But it's so much worse than even that. Because we have to follow Finn and Poe's obstacle course to catch up with them. Nice one, Finn and Poe. You really came through. To be concluded. Alright, that's where this one leaves. Off to a entertaining start. We'll see what happens. Tales of Villainy. Alright, I've been looking forward to this. Invasion of Echo Base. Oh shit, someone let Veers Watch know. We've got a Veers sighting right here. Lord Vader, I have reached the main power generators. The shield will be down in moments. You may start your landing. There's that sexy Lambda we were just talking about coming down. Ugh! And the snow troopers. Such a good design. Makes me think of the Finnish Special Forces in World War II.
The Force is strong with this one.
Nice. Look at that intense-ass expression on this guy's face. And, you know what? Actually, you can only see... I might be just in the way, but... On this Rebel on the far right, you can just see a little tuft of purple sideburns. Mutton chops coming out the side there. There's no skin tone visible. I wonder if he's a Lasat. Could be. This, for some reason, this image just really makes me think about Battlefront Twilight Company by Alexander Freed and his depiction of the Battle of Hoth, because it was some of the grittiest, most brutal Star Wars action writing I've ever read. Highly recommend it.
Commander, push these rebels and find access to the command center.
Yes, Lord Vader.
Seek out the leadership, Captain. The Princess Rykin. Capture the smuggler if you can. At all costs, find and detain the X-Wing pilot, Skywalker. I want him alive.
Yes, my lord.
He's opening the doors. Hey, Splinter. Hello there. Hey, no worries, Henry. Thanks for tuning in, man.
Vroom!
Actually, that's more of a... Because he's rending the metal.
Imperial troops have entered the base! Imperial troops have...
Press forward.
Yes.
All troops, disengage.
And get to your transports.
Wait for me!
Wow. Seeing the back of the tank that Luke was just in after his Wampa attack, and it just sends him down memory lane. Thinking about himself healing in here, side by side with his son. And then here he is burning in Mustafar, side by side with Luke freezing on the wastes, seeing a new vision of Obi-Wan. Man, that's very powerful. He's getting this vision through the Force. That's amazing.
Hey you, stop right there! After them! They must have gone in here.
Oh, is this the deleted scene? With the ripped off Wampa? Fuck yes. Okay, yeah, go on in there, buddy. See what happens.
Roar!
What the?
Yow!
Yes. I just said yow. This is amazing, and I love that this has been given life again.
Status?
My lord, there are no, rebels.
No rebels in this area, sir.
They are close.
Look at that. Just destruction. It really was a pretty decisive Imperial victory, if you don't count the fact that Rebel Command escaped. In terms of pitched battles, the Imperials just won.
Transport, this is Solo. Better get off. Better take off. I can't get to you. I'll get her out on the Falcon. Lord Vader, the smuggler Solo has been spotted in your sector. He has the princess with him.
Captain Solo must be attempting to escape with the princess on the Millennium Falcon. All units converge on my position. Go, stop them.
I agree, Jacqueline, that is some excellent visual storytelling, and yes, it is officially canonized again. I believe its status was not canon because of its deleted scene, so yeah, there we go.
Go, stop them.
Ugh. Look at this badass, this cool guy who doesn't look as the walker comes down. He's just like, I'm done with this shit. That's the panel right there. That is the panel. Would it help if I got out and pushed? It might. Captain Solo, Captain Solo. Everyone knows how to do that sound.
Set up the cannon, quickly.
That would be an E-Web heavy repeating blaster cannon, the likes of which Moff Gideon set up to try and flush out Din Djarin, Cara Dune, and Carl Weathers, because I forget his name, Greef Karga, the finale of The Mandalorian. And just like that, by the skin of their ass, they escape.
Admiral Piet, the Millennium Falcon is leaving the Hoth atmosphere. Prepare to intercept. I want that ship, Admiral.
Yes, my lord.
If I cannot find him, then perhaps Skywalker will come to me.
The end. That was good. That was short and sweet. These tales of villainy actually brought a lot more to the table than I was expecting. I don't want to sound like I don't think Star Wars Adventures is a legit Star Wars series, because it really has had a couple moments that I've really enjoyed. It's never made it on my list of favorite comics. Tales from Vader's Castle came pretty close. Those were awesome. But this moment, and I'm going to back up to it, of Vader encountering the Bacta tank and having this, I'm going to go ahead and call it a force vision of connectivity with his son. I'm going to say that this is one of my favorite moments in the 2020 releases of comics anyway that I've seen. The art style is very different, obviously, but thematically, it reminds me a lot of some of the takes that Giuseppe Camuncoli did with the Vader Dark Lords of the Sith line last year, with his dark meditation panels. I'm never not going to bring those up, by the way, so you can just deal with it, because I love those panels. My favorite. Harvey YJT12, I get my comics from comixology.com. You can download them that way. You can link it with an Amazon account as well. It's pretty free. It's not free, but it's cheap and easy to use. Yeah. And as for Legends comics, I actually have them all on digital. I have CBR files, and I have a hard drive with every Legends comic that came out prior to 2014. So we're going to dive into those in the future as well. The Welsh MJ, Ralph McQuarrie is probably the greatest asset to any sci-fi fantasy project. Star Wars, Star Trek, Wonderworld, Battlestar, E.T., Cocoon, he doesn't get enough credit. I 100% agree with you. Ralph McQuarrie does not get enough credit, but I love that he is still being used to this day. The new canon releases of Star Wars, the sequel trilogy, Rogue One, Ralph McQuarrie's name is in those credits because they farmed his original designs. And when they go back and they use previously unused things that he created and insert them into Star Wars, it just looks like it belongs. A great example of that would be the AT-DPs in Star Wars Rebels. Was a proto AT-ST drawing by Ralph McQuarrie, and they just transported it in, and it just looks like another Walker variant. It works. Ezra Bridger's famous face-opening Imperial helmet, same story. That was an early Stormtrooper design. Yeah, no, I love it. Also, the I want to call it a Commodore-class cruiser, but I know that's not accurate. But the deleted scene from Solo, A Star Wars Story, where he's doing his Imperial Flight Academy training, they fly towards one. And that is also an unused Star Wars design. I'm not sure if that one was actually RF McQuarrie, though, now that I say that out loud. Handsome Jacqueline, the art style of Rebels itself being heavily based on his work, too. Yes, absolutely, just in the overall sense. The show reads like a love letter to Ralph McQuarrie's visual styles. You got the skinny sabers, you got the extra long necks on the Star Destroyers. It all kind of just circles back to how he did his styles. One of the things that makes him so iconic, in my opinion, is that, unlike other concept artists and designers of that era, he would draw things from cinematic perspectives. Rather than, typical design work where you're 90 degrees, 180 degrees, you know, and fleshing out characters. He would flesh out, like, camera shots and camera angles and depict the entire scene happening in that way. And that was very revolutionary to both how concept art nowadays is just done. Like, that's just considered a tenet of how you do it. But also in developing the visual language of Star Wars. And that the importance of that cannot be overstated. So, that's my rant about Ralph McQuarrie. Thanks for bringing it up. No problem, Harvey. You actually made it for the whole stream because this is pretty much it. We're out of comics for this week. So I hope you guys enjoyed. If you missed the stream, fear not. It's going to get archived onto YouTube later on today, so you can check it out then. Thanks for watching, everybody. And as always, may the Force be with you.